أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم. بفضل الله، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على خير خلق الله أجمعين، محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين، واللعنته الدائمة على أعدائهم أجمعين إلى قيام يوم الدين. قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في محكم كتابه الكريم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: لن تنالوا البر حتى تنفقوا مما تحبون، وما تنفقوا من شيء فإن الله به عليم. صدق الله العلي العظيم. And you shall never attain goodness until you give of what you love, and of whatever you give, anything that you give, then verily Allah is all knowing. Sadaq Allah al Aliyyul Azim. This verse is an encouragement for people to give in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins the verse by saying that lan tanalul bir, that he says that you shall never. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses lan, it means that it's impossible. There is no way for you to reach good with the exception that you give of what you love. The whole verse is based on the pretense that everything you have, that everything that is being given to you, is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When they ask Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that you don't need to pray or do anything because you are God's chosen prophet, you are Habibullah, that why do you do this? He says, should I then not be a grateful servant? Should I then not be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of what He has given me? That everything that you have been given is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you give, you're not really giving anything away because He gave it to you and He will give you more of what you give away. However, when you do give, it has to be of what you love. There are many rewards to giving alms, to giving sadaqah. And sadaqah has many forms as well. And we will speak about these forms. But firstly, let's take the example of the children of the Prophet Adam, salamullahi alayhi. Nabi Adam alayhi salam had two children. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the example of those two. And more. He had more children afterwards. But these two mainly, which are Cain and Abel, Qabil and Habil. These two children of Nabi Adam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us one of the first and most important examples. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked of them a sacrifice, to give something. So Habil went and chose the best wheat that he has in his harvest. So the finest golden wheat, this is what he gave to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he places it and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends a fire to eat it up as a sign of acceptance. That Allah has accepted, Walaykum As-Salaam wa Rahmatullah, Allah has accepted this sacrifice, what He has given. And then Qabil sees this and says, well, I want to give a sacrifice as well. What does he give? He goes and gives an old mangy sheep. He has a sheep that's about to die. So he says, all right, of the sheep that I have, I'm going to give this one because it's going to die anyway. So he puts it and the fire doesn't come down and accept it. So he gets upset. And when he gets upset, he gets jealous. And through his jealousy, he aims to kill his brother, Habil, the good one. And he does, he ends up killing him because of this. The reason why it wasn't accepted, or there's many reasons, of them is because Allah only accepts from the muttaqeen, He only accepts from the pious and the God-fearing. That for you to do an action and for it to be accepted, you have to be God-fearing. It's just like, for example, if I go now and clean the streets, the main street of Kogra, and then I go up to Kogra Council and say, alright, I want you to pay me $10,000 because I've just cleaned up, you know, Railway Street, the whole street. They'll laugh at me. They'll say, firstly, you're not employed by us. There was no contract between us. You don't recognize us as the council. And you're just doing your own thing and then you want to get paid. It's not going to happen. In the same way, when you do something as a good deed, but you're not doing it by the rules of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to do, then what does it equate? It equals to nothing. فَكَانَتْ هَبَاءً مَنْثُورًا. In the verse in the Holy Quran, وقدمنا إلى ما عملوا من عمل. That on this day when they come and they bring the deeds that they have done, and they will see it like scattered dust. The others that do deeds, but they don't have the belief. They don't accept Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as their creator. They don't have the correct belief. Their deeds will be scattered. So firstly, you have to be part of it. You have to be a believer. Middle Mu'mineen, doesn't he say, Dinakum dinakum, tamassaku bidina. He says that your religion, hold tight to your religion. وَلَا يَزَيِّلَنَّكُمْ. He says, and do not allow anybody to push you away from this religion or take you away. لَأَنَّ الْحَسَنَةَ فِيهِ خَيْرٌ مِنَ السَّيِّئَةِ فِي غَيْرِ. فَإِنَّ الْحَسَنَةَ فِيهِ تُقْبَلْ فَإِنَّ السَّيِّئَةِ فِيهِ تُغْفَرْ وَالْحَسَنَةَ فِي غَيْرِهِ لَا تُقْبَلْ. That he says that if you do a good deed in other than this faith, it won't be accepted. But if you sin and you're in on the right faith, then at least Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive your sin. You can gain forgiveness. So he says, make sure, don't let anyone push you away from this faith. That's one. The second and the most important point that I want to concentrate on tonight is the fact that they gave of what they loved. The fact that they gave of what they loved. That Nabi Habil, or Habil the son of Nabi Adam alayhi salam, gave of what he loved. That's why it was accepted by Allah, and the other one didn't give of what he loved. In fact, the verse that we read in the beginning, وَلَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرْ, this verse came down in some traditions for an event that took place with the daughter of the Prophet Fatima al-Zahra salawatullahi alayha. An event that is unprecedented in history, nor will you probably ever see it till the day of judgment. It's something that when you really and truly think about it, is such an amazing act of charity and alms. That Fatima al-Zahra salawatullahi alayha, on her wedding night, she's going to get married and she has her wedding dress. And the poor lady comes and asks that, I have no clothing, give me some clothing. So the narration says that Fatima salawatullahi alayha looks at her new dress and looks at her old dress. This is a situation that I think we all fall into, not to that magnitude, but on a daily basis. When we asked by Allah that we need to give, for example, someone comes up and tells you about khums, and you say, what's this khums? That you have to give a fifth of your profits, and you say, what are you talking about? I already pay income tax, and I pay, I don't know what, GST, and then on top of that, I have to pay khums. It's difficult. Or if someone says, you know, the poor people need something, or, you know, we're sending money, even though no amount is too small. But I'm saying, if you want to be truly, truly honest with yourself. And so she says, she looks at the two dresses. One is the wedding dress that she's going to wear on her wedding night, and one is her old dress that she's wearing. She doesn't have a collection of clothing like the majority of us, men and women included, a huge collection of clothing, half of which we wear sometimes, some which we never wear. That this is all she has. And she thinks, what shall I give? And then she remembers this verse. She remembers that Allah says, you will not achieve goodness until you give of what you love. So she says, I love this wedding dress. She gives the wedding dress to the poor lady, and she gets married in her regular clothing, because she gave that as a gift. Now, if we put it into perspective, into context, that if we look at the detail today that we would, that a woman, one of our sisters or our daughters or whoever, or our wives would have went through to gain a wedding dress, the amount of alterations they do as their weight fluctuates, the amount of decorations and styles that they place into it, and money, and the stress of thought about the whole thing, and then imagine finally you get it, and then you expect it to give it away. There's no way they'd give it away. You'd have a better chance taking the blood of a bride than taking her wedding dress away from her. And then, we're not talking about a regular person, but you're talking about the daughter of Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That yes, he is a prophet, but in context, this is a person who was the like of a king. He didn't act like a king, but he had ownership of the whole Arabian Peninsula and so many countries, that people would give him anything that he had asked for. That the whole world was created for him. So imagine the biggest, wealthiest king's daughter giving away her wedding dress. This is something that you'll never see again in your life. And this is what she gives to show that you have to give of what you love. That it's very important to give of what you love. The other thing that it shows is that any good deed that you commit to, wherever it is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make it apparent. Even if you hide it, you know, it's recommended to give alms, to give charity, and you should hide your right hand from your left hand. They don't even let your left hand see the right hand giving the charity. The purpose being that on the day of judgment, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala seals the mouths, and He allows the hands and the feet to talk, they will talk and say, this is what I did, this is what I did, that the left hand won't be able to witness to the right hand giving. That's how secret it was. And we have traditions that say it's good to give openly as well, to encourage other people. You give of your wealth openly and you encourage others, and this pushes away mawtatussu, the difficult death. If you give openly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will save you from a difficult death. Difficult death is a death by burning, for example, a death by drowning. They say that the person who dies drowning, bimanzilat al-shaheed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him the reward of a shaheed, because this is how difficult drowning is. That your oxygen gets taken away. It's very difficult. And slowly, slowly you die. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives this great reward for a person that dies like that. So if you pay openly, it takes that away. If you pay secretly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make it known. If not today, if not in 10 years, if not in 50 years, it will be known that this person gave or did this good action wholeheartedly, with sincerity, and he gave something of what he loved. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives the example for Nabi Musa alayhi salam. He tells him to do a few tasks, and then he explains the tasks. Of the tasks is, he takes a box of gold, and he says to him, take this box of gold and bury it. So the Nabi takes it alayhi salam, and he buries it, and he walks away. The box of gold comes out of the earth again. So he goes back to look at it and he says, I've done my bit. I was told to bury it. I buried it. I'm walking away. So when he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what's the meaning? He says, the meaning of this is, no matter what good deed you do, and no matter how you hide it, I will always make it come back and make it apparent. The story of a man, or a king, sorry, who was hunting. And he lost his way. I'm sure you've all heard this story. But it's good to put the idea of giving into perspective. So this king was hunting, and he had his men with him, and they were all hunting together, and he got lost away from his men, and his men went back to the palace, and he was just in the jungle and in the forest, and he didn't know where to go. So he's walking through the forest, he starts to get hungry, he starts to get thirsty, he begins to get close to death. As he's going, he finds a small hut. Inside the small hut, there's an old man and an old lady living in the hut. He comes to them. They don't realize he's a king, because he's in his hunting gear, and he's probably lost half his clothing from the difficulty that he was going through. He got rid of his armor and his weapons from the hunger and thirst. So they take him in, and he says to them, I'm going to die. They say to him, look, all we have is this goat. We'll sacrifice this goat. First we'll milk it. You can drink from its milk, and then we'll kill it, and you can have the meat and eat. But this is all we have. He says, "That's whatever you want to do. You do what you want to do." So they kill the goat, they milk it first, then they kill it, they give him the milk, they give him the food. He gets back to health, and he tells them, this is my name, and I live in such and such a town. If you go to this town, ask about me. And then he goes on his merry way. They let him go. So he goes back to his hometown. Months pass. One day this old man and old lady, they're talking to each other, and they say, let's go and see who this man is, because now we're living in hard times. We had that goat, now we don't even have the goat, we have nothing. So let's go and see what he has to offer us. So they go to the town, and they say, that they ask in the town about so-and-so. They say, are you sure you've got the name right? They say, yes, this is his name. They say to them, this is the king of this town, the king of this land. And so they say, wow. So where do we go? They say, go to the palace. They enter the palace, they go into the courtyard, and they say to him, king, we're here. You told us to meet you. So he greets them. He says, you know, it's very good to have you here, very good to see you. But then he starts thinking to himself, what shall I give them as a reward? So he asks his courtiers and his advisors who are sitting around him. He says to them, this is the story. 1, 2, 3. I got lost, etc. They hear the story. He says, what would be a worthy reward? What would be a worthy reward? So they say to him that the only worthy reward is for you to give them your whole kingdom. He says to them, what sort of reward is this? They say, because when you were lost and you were in need, they only had the goat that was their whole wealth. They gave you their whole wealth when you were in need, so it would only, the best way to repay them would be to give them the same that of what they gave you in comparison. So if you think about it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us our whole world, every link that we have, every connection that we have, every like and hate, every love, every dislike. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us all of these things. In the same way, when we look at Abu Abdullah al-Husayn salawatullahi alayhi, who gave everything, and we mentioned this yesterday, that he set that precedent, that he gave everything in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as you can see, this is of the rewards of Imam al-Husayn salawatullahi alayhi. No one needed an invite to come and listen to the majalis of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, to come to the gatherings of Imam al-Husayn. No one needed a specific invite. That's it, you know, your heart knows. Every year that at this time I come and listen, and I remember, and I hear about this great Imam, and I reinvigorate my identity of who I am. This is one of the greatest things that Abu Abdullah al-Husayn salawatullahi alayhi gave to Islam, is that he protected the identity of Islam. Now when I say Islam, obviously I mean the Shia. I mean the Shia. But the Shia, this is the true Islam. This is the only true Islam. The other sects are not on the right path. The other sects are completely misguided. So he was the one that allowed Islam to remain, that imagine, over 1,000 years, that in all of our countries, we have only been ruled by people that were in the other sects of Islam, that would destroy our sect of Islam, that wouldn't allow us to practice our form of Islam. In fact, in the early 1900s, the Shah of Iran, he wanted to eliminate the whole concept of Islam, like Mustafa Kemal Ataturk. How he eliminated it in Turkey completely, he even took away that in Turkey, that obviously this was the last days of the Khilafah, was in Turkey during the time of the Ottoman Khalifs, and what they owned was all in Turkey, so the national language of Turkey would have been Arabic, or at least within Arabic characters. But he eliminated it. Now we don't have Arabic characters. When you see Turkish writing, it's English characters with dots and strokes. He got rid of the Arabic characters to try and eliminate reading of the Quran. He eliminated everything to the degree that he says basically your Islam stays in the mosque. Don't bring it outside. That you even notice if you go to Auburn Mosque or possibly the mosques in Turkey, that when the Imam walks in, he walks in with normal clothes and he puts on his gown and his hat and he prays, and then when he finishes, he leaves him in the mosque and he walks out without. That's it, because the religion stays in the mosque. So Shah Pahlavi tried to do the same thing. What he wanted to do, he banned hijab, for example. He banned niqab, sorry. And then he banned hijab. He said that women can't wear hijab, so some women stayed in their houses for 20 years. They never came out because it was illegal. If a police officer would see you with it, they would take it off you. And then he banned the majalis of Imam al-Husayn. He says you can't gather and cry over Imam al-Husayn. So people used to go into the cemetery and just begin to cry. So the police, if they come and ask them why you're crying, they say we're crying over a dead relative. Just to maintain that. To maintain that identity. If it wasn't for Imam al-Husayn salawatullahi alayhi, we would have completely lost this identity. Countries that stopped remembering Abu Abdullah al-Husayn, countries like Bosnia. Bosnia was mostly Shia. The majority of Bosnia is Shia. Even if you speak to some Bosnians, go and ask them what their names of their grandfathers are. And you see that a lot of them have Shia names or names that are close to Shia names. Their grandfathers and their great-grandfathers have these sorts of first names because the majority of them were Shia, but they didn't know. And then when the Ottoman Empire took over, they forced them to be into whatever religion. But because they left the remembrance of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, they went astray. And alhamdulillah, there's many of them that are coming back to the right path. But the point is, because of what this Imam gave, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him so much blessings. And of these blessings is the upholding of the religion. Is all based on the remembrance of Abu Abdullah al-Husayn salawatullahi alayhi. Salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Wa salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. So, when it comes to giving, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us many examples. And there's many different stages and states of giving. Sadaqah, of the things regarding sadaqah, is the fact that as the hadith says, as-sadaqa tadfa'u al-bala. That if you pay sadaqa, if you give charity, alms, and charity can be many things of them, it can be just a smile. If you see your brother and you smile in his face, that's charity. If you bring a gift to your wife, that's charity. You bring a gift to your children, that's charity. This all counts as charity, but the best of charity is the one that's given to the people who are most needy, most in need. But this still counts as sadaqah. Giving to your family members, giving to the people who know, the poor that you know, for example, the poor within your own family, the poor within your extended family. So, smiling in the face, giving wealth, helping a brother, or helping a sister. That if they need something, that you go and you help them. There's an act of worship known as i'tikaf. I don't know if you've heard of it. Some have heard of it, some haven't. That this act of worship, usually they do it in the month, the holy month, Shahr Ramadan. And in this act of worship, you enter a mosque and you stay in the mosque for a minimum of 3 days. During this period, you fast. Minimum of 3 days. And you pray. You're not allowed to talk to anyone. All your talk has to be prayers or Quran or tasbih. That's it. 3 days. It's a type of worship. And the only time you can't even leave the mosque. For any reason, except for going to the toilet. Other than that, you can't leave. You have to stay inside the mosque the whole time. If you break that, when you enter, the minimum you can do is 3 days, or you can do more, you can do 10, you can do 30. But if you leave during that time, you have to pay a kafara. Part of this kafara is fasting for 60 days, 31 days straight, and then the other 29 can be broken. That this is how difficult it is, that you should never break. This is how sanctified afan, this act of worship is, that you should never break it. And if you do break it, there's a big kafara to pay for it. So one day Imam al-Hussein is in the act of i'tikaf, that he is in Masjid Baytullah al-Haram, near the Kaaba. And he's going to be there for a minimum of 3 days. A man comes to the Imam and he says, Sayyidu Mawlai, I am in trouble, I need your help. That no one else can help me with this one except for you. I have to go and see the governor of Mecca, and the only person that can help me with the governor of Mecca is you. So the Imam walks straight out of the mosque, breaks his i'tikaf there and then. Why? To help a person. This is how important it is to help your brethren. Imagine that. That's huge. That he tells him, this is something that is so great, that they tell us that this is how important it is to help one another. To help one another with anything. Somebody asks you a question, or somebody asks you about something. Addal ala al-khayr, kafa'iluh. A person who leads somebody to do something good. It's as if they have done that good action. Now in Islam, there are degrees of giving. Of the degrees of giving, or what is known as sakha, you have karam. And karam is to be a kareem, is to give for someone, if someone asks you to give them. Unfortunately, some people, this is why you should be careful who you ask. Make sure you ask somebody, and we have a hadith about this. Somebody that is high born, in other words, someone that's of noble birth. Because they won't turn you down because they're of noble birth. Somebody that's known for their generosity, they won't turn you down because they're generous. If you need, for whatever it is. So choose who you ask, so you're not humiliated. But if anyone asks, you always give. If you give, this is known as karam. You're a kareem if you give, if someone asks. Better than karam is jood. If someone that's known as a person that has jood, or is a jawad, that he gives, he has jood, it means that he gives without people asking. That he sees that somebody is in need, so he gives. He doesn't wait for them to break and ask. That before they break and ask, he gives, or he offers. He offers at least. They reject the offer, it's something else. You see somebody's doing it tough, you give. You don't have to send it by your own hand. You can send it through somebody else. You can do it in a very hidden way. In fact, the Imam, most of the time, would cover his face. Or he would give from behind the door. They would ask him why. They know it's your house. He says, yes, but I don't want to see the face of the humble. This humiliated face that please give me. And he's got to humiliate. I don't want to look into that face and make him feel even worse. So I get behind the door and I give him, or I cover my face. Imam al-Hussein salawatullahi alayhi, and I mentioned this already, on the day of Ashura, that there was marks on his back, and so they ask Imam Zain al-Abidin, what are the marks on his back, like calluses on his back? He says, this is from holding the sacks of food when he used to go out at night and give to them with his face covered. Give to the orphans and the widows, and they would never know until after he died, Then they realized that the one who used to give us, we didn't know who he was, but he is gone now, so it must have been Abu Abdullah al-Husayn salawatullahi alayhi. And greater than Jood is Ithar. And if somebody commits an act of Ithar, it is to give. Ithar is to give, is to take away from yourself and give. So for example, I have one meal and a hungry person comes, I go without and I give to them, this is Ithar. So that's even greater. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remembers the Ahlul Bayt for this exactly. وَيُطْعِمُونَ الطَّعَامَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ مِسْكِينًا وَيَتِيمًا وَأَسِيرًا. The verse in the Holy Quran, remember the story, Imam al-Hasan al-Husayn gets sick to the rest of it. And so they fast 3 days. The Ahlul Bayt decide to fast 3 days. And when they fast 3 days every night, somebody comes to them one night, an orphan comes to them, so they give him the food and they go without. This is Ithar. The next night, a prisoner comes who is a kafir, they give to him and they go without. The night afterwards, who comes to them? A traveler. A person that's just traveling. And so they give him. And they go without for 3 nights. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remembers this in the Holy Quran. It's to let everyone know that this secret act that they committed to of sadaqah will be known to everybody. Forever. It will be immortalized in the Holy Quran. The next level above that is muwasat. And muwasat basically means... Muwasat basically means that you can't give this person. You know how if you hear of someone that's oppressed, the Holy Prophet says, do one of three. Either help him with your hand. If you can't help with your hand, then help with your tongue. Say something. If you can't help with your tongue, then help with your heart. So what's help with my heart? Feel bad? Maybe. But perhaps the feel bad is like muwasat. That for example, I hear of somebody that's in a faraway place. For example, I hear about a prisoner of conscience that he's been stuck in solitary confinement. So I sit myself for 1 hour at least in solitary confinement to feel what he's feeling because I can't help him. Or I hear that there's somebody somewhere that has no bed, but I have a nice king-size bed. So for a week or a day or a month or until I can help him, I sleep on the floor. This is muwasat. That I have the bed, but I can't give it to you. But I want to feel what you're feeling. This is what it is. It's like empathy. It's like empathizing with the person. And this is of the greatest levels of giving. The highest levels of giving. Because when you feel it, you feel the pain, you'll do something about it. When you feel the pain of somebody that is oppressed in this manner, then you will do something about it. And tonight, my brothers, is the night of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. نعم الأخ المواسي لأخي. That this brother who couldn't give what was requested of him, so therefore he wouldn't take himself. Turn off the lights, brothers, please, so maybe I can try and make someone cry in remembrance to Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, because we couldn't be with Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. On the day of Ashura, Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas sends out his 4 brothers to battle, and they get martyred one by one. He does this so he can feel some of the pain of Abu Abdullah al-Husayn. That Abu Abdullah is going to see his whole family go, so Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas stands by, and he says to Abu Abdullah, he says, Sayyidi Mawlai, Halli min rukhsa? Will you give me permission to go out and fight onto the battlefield? For verily my heart has become tightened. I feel my chest is tightening because all of my brethren have been before me and they have died, they have been killed. Now my chest has tightened and I've had enough of this life with these people. Give me permission to go and take revenge. So Abu Abdullah al-Husayn, he says to his brother, Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, he says to him, O Abbas, anta akhi wa sahiba liwa'i. He says, you are my brother and you are the one who is my flag bearer. I'm afraid if my flag falls to the ground, then my army will be scattered. And can you not hear the voices of Sukayna and Rukayya? They are saying, al-atash, al-atash, that they are so thirsty, rather than a mission of revenge. O Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, go towards the river Euphrates and bring some water back for Sukayna and Rukayya. And Abdullah al-Radi'ah, Aliyun al-Asghar, his mother's chest has dried out, there is no more milk for him. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas attacks the 4,000 soldiers guarding the Euphrates like a vicious lion. He pushes them apart and he gets to the river Euphrates in the heat of the desert. He lifts the water with his hand and he brings it to the face and feels the coolness to his face. and feels the coolness of the water, and he says to himself, O self, that you will never be able to touch this water. How dare you touch this water while your brother Hussein is thirsty and waiting for some water? Ya nafs min ba'd al-Husayn ihuni, in kunti aw la takuni, min ba'dihi in kunti aw la takuni, hadha Husayn warid al-manuni wa tashrabini barid al-ma'ini. He says, your brother Hussein is going to face death and you are drinking the coolness of this water. He throws the cool water, even though we would have never thought any less of Abul Fadl al-Abbas. Had he drank of the water, he faces the camp of Imam al-Husayn. He is thinking of Sukayna and Rukayya, saying, Al-Atash, Al-Atash, waiting for this water. He cannot wait to see them and meet them with this bag of water that he is carrying. Abu al-Fadl Abbas begins to head back towards the camp of Imam al-Husayn. As he is heading back, they ambush him, and one of the enemy cuts off his right hand. He says, by Allah, if you cut off my right, I will forever stand for my religion and protect my religion. Wallahi, in qata'tumu yamini, inni uhami abadan an dini. Forever I will protect my religion, so protect your religion, O Muslims. And then in another ambush, they cut off the left hand of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. Al-Abbas carries the bag or the kurba of water in his mouth. He still has hope that he will make it until an arrow hits the bag and the water floods onto the ground. How will he face Sukayna? How will he face Rukayya? How will he face As-Saghir, who have asked for water and they are screaming, Al-Atash, Al-Atash, Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. He doesn't know whether to move forward or back, and then an arrow hits him in the eye, and one of the enemies hits him with a metal pole on the head. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas falls to the ground. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas is writhing on the ground, and he is splattered in his own blood. He calls out to his brother, whom he usually calls Sayyidi wa Mawlai. He calls to him, Akha Hussein. Al-Imam al-Hussein, he is his brother, and he comes down like a vicious hawk. He kills all of the enemy and stands above the body of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas says to him, he feels the shadow of someone shading him from the sun. He says, oh, you, please wait till my brother al-Hussein, to my master al-Hussein comes to me so I can see him for one last time. And then he says to him, I am your brother Hussein. He kneels down and gets the head of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas and places it on his lap. Abu al-Fadl moves off the lap of Imam al-Hussein and places his head on the floor. Imam al-Hussein lifts his head up one more time, and Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas takes off his head and puts it on the floor. Imam al-Hussein says, brother Abu al-Fadl, why do you keep moving your head off my lap? He says, oh Hussein, who will put your head on their lap on the day of Ashura? Who will put your head on their lap on the day that you will be martyred? وَسَيَعْلَمُ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا أَيَّ مُنْقَلِبٍ يَنْقَلِبُونَ وَالْعَاقِبَةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك عليكم مني جميعا سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم together. As-salamu ala al-Husayn wa ala Ali ibn al-Husayn wa ala awlad al-Husayn wa ala ashab al-Husayn. O Allah, hasten the reappearance of our holy Imam Ajla Fajr al-Sharif. O Allah, give us a position on the Day of Judgment to be by the side of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. O Allah, cure our sick, have mercy on our dead, O Allah. Repay our debts, O Allah. Free our political prisoners of conscience and any of these prisoners that have been placed unlawfully behind bars. O Allah, accept this little from us. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين ورحم الله من قرأ سورة المباركة الفاتحة وأهدى ثوابها إلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات. صلى الله على محمد وآل محمد.